Thanks very much. This week's talk will be given by Adrian Ball, who works, as you know, at the National Nuclear Laboratory. And without further ado, I will leave it over to him.
Don't clap yet because I haven't done anything. Thank you, Marcus. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to come and speak here. It's actually the second time I've done a talk to PhilSoc. I did one probably 10 years ago now when I worked for a company called Westinghouse. And I am, in fact, a former PhilSoc member going back to the late 1970s. So, yeah, and I know that was about 20 years before you were all born. So, very scary for me, even more for you. Like I said, I'm the External Relations Director for the National Nuclear Laboratory. We're based in the northwest of England. I'm based in Warrington. I live in Manchester, but my office is based in Warrington. I spend a lot of time in Cumbria, where we've got about half of our people based, about 500 or so based in near Sellafield in West Cumbria. I spend a lot of time in London as well. But it's nice to have an opportunity to do a talk in Manchester on a Friday evening. It gets me home a bit earlier. I'm going to cover three things, really. A little bit about the background to nuclear energy in the UK. I'll talk about current prospects for building new nuclear stations and where we're up to with that. And then quite specifically, because I was asked if I'd cover something on thorium, I'll talk over a few slides about the potential role for thorium fuel as an alternative nuclear fuel to uranium and what some of the pros and cons of that might be. So just to begin with, I'm conscious that some of you may know a little bit about the nuclear industry already, some of you may know a bit less, so some apologies to those who are not telling what you already know. And first of all, you won't be able to read those words, uranium ore. This is what's called the nuclear fuel cycle. It's how the kind of the whole of the nuclear industry fits together. The bit that we're mainly going to focus on today is the top right-hand corner, the reactors that generate the electricity from splitting of uranium atoms, creating lots of heat, and using that heat to drive turbines to make electricity. Fitting all around that is how do we get the nuclear fuel into the reactors and how do we deal with it afterwards. So we mine natural uranium, not in this country, but in other parts of the world. It gets converted and enriched and concentrated up. It's a bit like the reverse of making sort of fruit juice from Ribena. You're kind of concentrating it up to make the isotope, the flavour, if you like, of uranium that is the one that we really want, that's useful, that can be split to generate that heat in reactors. So we concentrate it up from natural uranium, make that into nuclear fuel pellets that go into nuclear fuel rods. They go into the reactor. As I said, the uranium atoms get split and generate a lot of heat that is used for the energy. We take away then the used fuel. It's actually much more dangerous and more hazardous to handle when it comes out than on the way in. New fuel you could handle with your bare hands quite easily. It wouldn't be dangerous to do that at all. It's when it comes out with all of those split, if you like, half atoms that are atoms of new material. Many of those are very, very radioactive, give off a lot of radiation, so it's harder to handle on the way out. That then goes either for reprocessing, for recycling and taking out the material that we can use again and put back into the cycle, or disposal of waste to be managed safely for future, out into the future. And that uranium and also plutonium can go back into the fuel cycle so we can use the material that we didn't use the first time. So that's the, if you like, the fuel cycle. We've got almost all of that apart from the uranium mining bit in the UK, and the vast majority of it is in the northwest of the UK, so within 2 or 3 hours drive of where we are here. And in the UK, in our industry, we were one of the pioneers, if not the pioneering country to have nuclear power in the first place. Almost 60 years ago, the first reactor at Calder Hall in West Cumbria was officially opened by Her Majesty the Queen. If I feel old coming back here after 40 years, the Queen must feel pretty old, because she's lived through the entire nuclear industry in our country almost 60 years in the same job without any prospect of promotion. So that's a scary thought for her. We've got a whole fuel cycle capability in the UK, as I mentioned, all of those aspects that I showed on the previous slide we've got here in Britain. Very, very skilled workforce. A lot of supply chain companies that provide the services and the materials and the knowledge into that industry, as well as purely nuclear companies. A very, very good safety record. I haven't got time to talk in detail about all of that, but we're also a world leader both in operating reactors, because we've operated a large number of different types of reactors, but also in taking down and decommissioning, if you like, dealing with the used reactors and fuel plants and manufacturing plants, taking out the radioactive equipment that's in there, taking the buildings down and building new facilities in their place. And we find ourselves now, as I'll say more about later, at the forefront really of the world's nuclear renaissance, thinking about building new nuclear stations here in the way that many other countries are as well. Our electricity mix is about 19% nuclear. This is actually 2013 statistics, so I should have dug out the 2014 numbers, but it's about the same. So just about one-fifth of our electricity, or a little bit less, comes from nuclear power. But if you look at the rest of it, about 30% from gas and around 30 to 40% coming from coal. So the vast majority from fossil fuels producing carbon dioxide that we all know is a bad thing. Renewables account for about 10% of our electricity on average through the year. And a little bit from oil, little bits from other things like imports and so on as well. But that 19% is made up of electricity from a number of existing nuclear stations, many of which are getting towards the end of their lifetimes. So these are the closure dates as they're currently announced for all of the UK's nuclear stations at the moment. Wilford, it actually says 2014, it will run on into around the middle of 2015. That's the oldest operating station that we have, the last of the first generation of what were called Magnox reactors, the very first design called the Hall. It's the pioneer of that series of nuclear power stations. Wilf is the last one to close in a few months' time. All of the rest are what are called advanced gas-cooled reactors. That's a design that nobody else in the world has operated. It's a uniquely British design. We've got four different varieties of that around those other stations. And the one exception is Sizewell B, which is a water-cooled, pressurised water reactor. That's the same kind of technology that most of the rest of the world uses for their nuclear power generation. And all of the new designs that I'm going to be talking about in a moment are water-cooled reactors, so they're more of those international standard designs that the rest of the world is using. But you'll see from some of the dates on there that mostly around the next 10 years or so, Dungeness, again, has just about last week been extended from 2018. You've got a 10-year lifetime extension to run to 2028. So they may not necessarily close on these dates, but it's a bit like an MOT on a car. They may be able to get another 5 years or 10 years operation, but that's by no means guaranteed. So if we don't build any new stations, then in 10, 15 years' time, we could see we're down to the last one or two nuclear stations left in the UK. So part of the challenge is how do we get the new ones up and on stream working before the old ones, the existing ones, finish. Just a little bit about why the politicians and why the industry wants to see nuclear coming on stream. Three reasons, really, and this illustrates that carbon dioxide, greenhouse gas, benefit that I mentioned earlier on before. When you look at fossil fuels, coal there on the left and gas are by far the most polluting technologies. Red bars indicate the carbon emissions that come directly out of the stack of the power station. The extra white bit on top is all of the emissions associated with the rest of that fuel cycle. So things like mining coal and transporting it around, building the power stations and demolishing them. And you'll see as we go from left to right, from coal to gas, to hydro, solar, wind and nuclear is there or thereabouts at the end. There's a couple of bars for each of those, depending on sort of older technology and newer technology. But the bottom line is nuclear is about there or thereabouts in terms of carbon emissions with the best of the renewables. They're both dramatically lower than fossil fuel emissions. So that's the reason why we want to get as much renewable and as much nuclear onto the grid as possible to help bring our carbon emissions down. And the move towards building new nuclear stations goes back almost 10 years now. Tony Blair was Prime Minister in 2006. It was about that time he started to announce government moves to allow nuclear stations to be built again. There had been a block from government up until that point on building any new stations from about the 1980s, 90s onwards. And the things that he was highlighting in his speeches, actually to the CBI annual dinner, reducing carbon dioxide emissions and improving our self-sufficiency, if you like, in energy, not being over-reliant on gas that was coming from elsewhere in the world, particularly a lot of the world's gas reserves come from the Middle East and from northern Russia. And you'll have seen in newspaper reports just recently, again, some of the worries about whether the Russians are going to allow Europe to have as much gas as we would like, as much gas as we need, So people are getting very worried and concerned about over-reliance on foreign gas supplies. So couple that with the carbon challenge, couple that with the need for affordable energy, and government were basically opening the door to investors to say, you're allowed to invest in new nuclear stations if you want to. So I'll put a slide up here about some of the challenges that those companies, the electricity companies, need to overcome before they can think about building new nuclear stations. And some of these will be very relevant when we talk about thorium later on in the talk. There's a number of them. The ability to license the design, to prove that it's safe to the regulators. Nobody can build anything and operate it until the regulators have approved it as being safe to run. The availability of the supply chain companies to make the bits for the reactors and the skills to build them and run them. Being able to build them on time and to budget is very, very important, particularly very complex designs in highly regulated like nuclear power stations. They want confidence in the plant's running costs, confidence in the operational performance. So basically they want to make sure it'll do what it says on the tin, that when they build this thing, it will generate vast quantities of electricity for a period of 40, 50, 60 years. Because without that, there's no way of those companies getting a massive investment back. You're looking at around 10 to 20 billion pounds to build a new nuclear power station with a couple of reactors. So massive, massive investment. And these are all businesses who have opportunities to invest their money elsewhere, not just in other kinds of power stations, but in other countries. So we have to convince them that the UK is the best place for them to spend their money. And then moving on, they want the ability to finance the project or to raise the money and have that secure to be able to spend on such a massive project, to get planning approvals, to be able to get revenue from the electricity price. They want to make sure that they can actually get a decent price for every unit of power that they sell, knowing how much they're going to have to spend to dispose of fuel and decommission the reactors, and also to make sure that a changing government in 5, 10, 20, 30 years isn't going to come in and say, right, we don't support nuclear anymore, we want to close down our nuclear stations for whatever reason. Because that would leave the company having spent a lot of money, not able to get their costs down. So a lot of certainty or high levels of confidence that those companies are needing. And I've split them into those two groups, and you might be able to make out a different colour, because the top half is really the industry's responsibility to deliver, to make sure we can deliver them on time and that they do what they say on the tin. The bottom half is down to government. So there's a lot of links between industry and government to make sure that all of these plans for new nuclear stations can actually happen. So Tony Blair made his nice remarks in a speech nearly 10 years ago. Where are we up to with that, standing here in February 2015, with those plans that people have talked about? Well, sorry, I should put up a health warning before I put that slide, inflict that upon you at this stage in the day. I could actually put Nigel Farage on there as well. Maybe that would have required a health warning. But we have now a situation for the first time in the UK nuclear industry's history where all three or all four of the main political parties are supportive of nuclear. The Labour Party, up until Tony Blair made those announcements, had always wavered about nuclear and really wasn't supportive. The Liberal Democrats had always been opponents of nuclear. As part of the coalition, they've actually overseen the last 5 years of progress on getting our stations built. So we now have, very importantly, cross-party consensus. And I'll tempt fate by saying it doesn't really matter what happens in this May's elections, but we are confidently expecting that the outcome of that election shouldn't impact on plans for building new nuclear stations. It's the first time we've actually had that level of political confidence. Please don't invite me back in June if that turns out not to be true. So the next question is, are we going to build more of the same? I mentioned the advanced gas-cooled reactors and the fact we have four different designs out of those seven reactors. If you look at all of our fleet, we've tended to change it every time we built one. And part of that is for good reason. In the early days of the industry, as a pioneer, when we were building those 11, I mentioned Magnox stations, there's actually 10 different designs amongst those 11 stations. And bizarrely, the only two that are the same were the first one and the second one, because they were actually built at the same time. After that, every time we built one, we learned a bit more. We knew how to make it better. We knew more about the fuel materials, the reactor materials. So they got more and more powerful. They were producing more electricity. They were using more advanced material, better technology. But it meant we ended up with one of everything. We didn't end up with a series of anything. We kind of did the same with the advanced gas-cooled reactor designs. Four designs across seven stations. And even the pressurized water reactor that we built was meant to be a straight copy of an American design. The time we've redesigned it three times in the UK, it turned out to be completely different from anything else in the world. has some advantages. We've got lots of different technology and lots of experience from building those. But when something goes wrong, we don't have spare parts sitting around for lots of individual different designs. You compare that with the French situation. 58 nuclear power stations in France, they get about 3/4 of their electricity from nuclear. They've essentially got 3 designs. So they pick a design, and they build it, and they build it, and they build it, and they build it, and then they build it some more. They know that they could build more advanced, technically superior designs, but they carry on building the first one because they get such a great economy of scale from operating a whole series of identical plants. And if you take that example of having 34 identical reactors, if you've got that many power stations, you can effectively have a 35th reactor in pieces in a warehouse on the outskirts of Paris. So that if something breaks and needs replacing on any of the operating stations, you can take that spare part, you can get it to the reactor, you can get the part replaced, get it up and running and back operating very, very quickly. Having a nuclear power station that's not generating electricity costs the operators something like £1 million a day in lost electricity revenue. You've still got to pay the people who work there. There's a large number of those. If you're not selling electricity, you're not making any money. So if that happens in the UK, we have to go right back out with the original drawings, back to a company that probably doesn't exist anymore, find somebody else who can make that part to nuclear specification, and a plant can be offline for weeks or months, losing a vast amount of money. So it might have seemed dumb at the time to carry on building the same less advanced design. The French model has worked really well for that. And that's important when we look at what kind of designs we're going to see built in future and what kind of technology we might want to see adopted in the longer term future. And a word about waste as well. One of the challenges to the nuclear industry has always been, well, you need to make sure you're disposing of your waste, and we've generated a lot of waste previously that needs disposal. Aren't we just going to carry on adding and adding to that problem? You may not be able to read the words very clearly on this slide. I've split this into two pie charts. The one on the left is higher level waste and intermediate, so that's things like used nuclear fuel casings. High-level waste is concentrated waste from the nuclear fuel itself, the very radioactive material that we separate out and concentrate up. The lower-level waste is things like concrete from buildings, overalls, paper towels, that kind of thing. The blue on each of these pie charts shows what we already have, or what we're already committed to generate by carrying on operating our existing power station. And if we were to replace our existing nuclear fleet with about 10 new reactors to generate the same amount of electricity and run those for 60 years, the orange shows you the extra waste that we would generate. So tiny amounts, about 10% on the left and about 3% on the right compared to what we already have. And part of the reason for that is that the technology has advanced so much since the very early days of the industry. The reactors we have now are much better designed to minimize waste. That's all built in into the design at the very start. In the early days, nobody really thought about how they were going to dispose of the waste from the reactors themselves or the waste material from the fuel. So, yes, we have a legacy. We're managing that waste legacy safely at the moment. A lot of that is stored above ground at the reactor sites or at Sellafield. We've got plans to dispose of it underground in the future. And if we have a new nuclear program, as people have got plans to build, we will make more waste. But it's only going to add about 1/10 to what we've already got in terms of the volume. So that's a really important point. We're not going to carry on doubling or trebling the waste that we already have. So going back to Tony Blair, when he was Prime Minister, you'll remember the date on his speech was, I think, May 2006. Took another 18 months until the government managed to produce a policy document, a white paper. I don't know why they call them white papers, it's got a blue cover, but it's a white paper, setting out their policy for building new nuclear stations. And the headline on there, nuclear power is a key role to play as part of the UK's energy mix. That's great. In many other countries, that would have meant the government were going to spend the government's money on building new nuclear stations. But in our country, the government made it very clear straight away they were basically going to say to the energy companies, you're allowed to build these now with your money. There's no government money going into funding power stations. And that was partly for political reasons, that previously power station projects had run over cost and over time and been a liability almost to some of the governments that had to fund them, particularly reactors that were first of a kind, where they'd have problems and delays in building the first of a brand new technology, so as I say, very, very highly regulated requirements. And don't forget, it was a Labour government, so the Labour Party was historically not the biggest supporter of nuclear. They'd come around to a view that they needed it for the reasons that I've talked about, but they were still very wary that by taking a pro-nuclear position as a historically an anti-nuclear party, that they might lose a lot of their voters coming up to an election. So government basically said, we're going to remove some of the obstacles so that new energy companies, and that's the likes of Npower and E.ON and EDF and Scottish Power and British Gas, Centrica, those other companies, you can, the names you see on the top of electricity bills, you can build nuclear stations if you want to with your own money, and we won't get any way. In fact, we'll remove some of the obstacles to allow you to do that. So they carried out and supported the industry in doing a whole load of things. I'm not going to run through all of those, but it was around doing environmental assessments, siting assessments, making the safety inspectors available to look at the nuclear designs. We still had to pay to get them looked at, so it's like having to pay someone to mark your homework to make sure that your reactor design is safe, and that was about £100 million per reactor design, just to get the kite mark of safety approval on that design to save the building. That the industry has had to pay for. And making very clear that there would be a national policy to allow nuclear stations to be built on pre-approved sites. So there's a system of pre-approving the reactor designs by doing the safety assessments, pre-approving some sites which were suitable for hosting new reactors. That was back in 2008, so again we're now 7 years on from there, and we still don't see a reactor operating. We still haven't got a firm decision yet to build a new nuclear station. So things move very, very slowly in our world. So I mentioned sites. Government went through a long and involved selection process to select, in the end, 8 sites that were pre-approved to host nuclear reactors. And the important thing about all of those 8 sites is they're all either existing nuclear sites or right next to existing nuclear sites. So all of them were very familiar with nuclear energy. In fact, most of the local communities were very keen to have a new nuclear station because they recognised the existing stations were going to close at some point, and that would mean an end to a lot of the high-paid, high-quality jobs in that in those local communities, quite often quite rural, quite rural communities. You can see they're all coastal sites because these nuclear stations need a lot of seawater to provide the ultimate cooling to take away some of that heat. So, all around England and Wales, for different political reasons, we're not able to build new nuclear stations in Scotland because of the views of their own Scottish Parliament. But Hartlepool in the North East, Sizewell in Suffolk, Bradwell in Essex, Hinkley Point in Somerset, which is likely to be the first of our new nuclear reactors if and when they do go ahead, Oldbury in Gloucestershire, the closest to where we are Wilford on Anglesey in North Wales, and Heysham up in Lancashire. And then Moorside, which is the only one that isn't an existing nuclear site, but that's right next to the Sellafield nuclear reprocessing site, the UK's biggest nuclear site, in fact, although it's not now any longer a power station, up in West Cumbria. 3 different companies, you'll see there that the names are colour-coded there, according to which different organisation has acquired the land on those sites and is looking to build nuclear stations on. And if I've got the slides in the right order, the next slide, it does, will show those three companies. EDF Energy are developing the Hinkley Point site. They want to build, they're a French company. EDF stands for Electricité de France, although they don't use that full name in the UK for obvious reasons. EDF Energy, French company, have chosen to build the French reactor design from a company called Areva. They're building 2 of them at Hinkley Point in Somerset, and when those are finished, they're planning to build 2 more of them at Sizewell in Suffolk, both of them, as I say, existing nuclear sites. For various reasons, I'll mention a little bit in a moment, but the government had to make some changes to the electricity market to guarantee a price for EDF Energy for 35 years of operation of those reactors. Our friends in Brussels in the European Parliament raised some eyebrows over that. They thought that was state aid and that it wasn't allowed under European rules. That had to go to a challenge to Brussels. That was finally approved in 2014 in October. And we're expecting EDF, if all goes well, to make their final investment decision my personal guess is they're not going to make it just before the election. I'll wait and see just what does happen in May, even though they're fairly confident. But sometime between May and the end of the year, they'll make their final investment decision to spend, in their case, about £16 billion on two new reactors at Hinkley Point. And when they make that investment decision, that will commit them to a lot of spend that they can't then reverse. One of the first things that they'll do is sign contracts for a lot of very expensive, big, thick stainless steel components for pressure vessels, for turbines, for steam generators, for other parts of the reactor. And once they sign those contracts, they're then committed to spend that money. So several billion will go out of the door effectively straight away. The next generator is a company called Horizon Nuclear Power. EDF, as I say, is owned in France. Horizon is owned by Hitachi, so that's owned by the Japanese. So they're building two Hitachi design reactors, General Electric Hitachi boiling water reactors. That's a technology we've never had before in the UK. We have pressurized water reactors, but not boiling water reactors. Planning to build two of those at the Wilfer site in Anglesey, and then two more at Oldbury in Gloucestershire. And the third of the three is a company called New Generation, that's owned by Toshiba, again in Japan, Westinghouse, which is an American company, and GDF Suez in France. So three of their reactor, the Westinghouse reactor, will be built at Moorside near Sellafield. So I said more of the same, or are we going to be building a standard series of designs? We're not actually picking one design and building it all across Britain for the next wave of nuclear stations. But the important thing to notice is that all of these three designs, the EPR, the boiling water reactor, and the last one, the Westinghouse design, are all being built elsewhere in the world, and in the case of the boiling water reactors, they're already operating elsewhere in the world. So we won't be building the first. And in fact, in the case of the Westinghouse one, they're building so many at the moment in the States and in China, that their reactors over here will be, let me get this right, the 17th, 18th, and 19th in their world series. So it'll be well-established technology in all of these cases, and we won't be hitting all of those first-of-a-kind problems. That's the plan. In terms of Hinkley Point C, this is a slide of roughly what it will look like. In the lower left-hand side, there is actually Hinkley Point A. That's now closed down. That was a first-generation Magnox station. Off the slide is Hinkley Point B, which is still operating. And a new nuclear station is there, Hinkley Point C, targeted to generate its first electricity in 2023. So that's still 8 years away from where we are now, even if they make that investment decision this year. And if you think back to some of those closure dates we had on one of the earlier slides, that's still cutting it fine in terms of getting the new ones up and running before the existing ones are now going to close down. Some people think 2023 is optimistic, so it could go longer than that. It's unlikely to be any earlier than that. And I mentioned before that market reform, the thing that the European Parliament raised their eyebrows at, just a little bit about how that works. If you look at this is actually a government slide to show how it works. The blue line there really shows you the market price of electricity and what it might or might not do in the future. So you can see it's going up a bit, down a bit, there'll be some peaks, there'll be some troughs, depending on all sorts of things. The electricity prices are notoriously variable and unpredictable. They depend on gas prices and oil prices mainly. Global prices, not just UK prices. If the market price is, let's say, £20 per megawatt hour, what the government have said is we'll top that up to an agreed fixed level, so what they call a strike price. They actually drew this slide showing it at £90 per unit. The contract they've actually agreed with EDF Energy is £92.50. per megawatt hour. That's twice the current market price for UK electricity. And that's why the European Union raised their eyebrows a little bit and said, hang on, this is effectively a state subsidy for EDF. The reality is everybody's expecting market prices to go up over coming years. Energy is not getting any cheaper for all sorts of reasons. And that price is fixed at that level, although index-linked, for a period of 35 years. So once that contract is signed, that ties everybody in to what the revenue is going to be for a period of 35 years, a very, very long time. If the market price happens to go above what that fixed price is, then the generator pays a little bit back to government. But I mentioned this is the way that government have drawn this picture themselves. Even they showed it only going above the fixed price for a very small amount of the time. So implicitly, everybody's kind of agreeing this is a subsidy to the electricity companies to make sure that they have the guaranteed revenue that will allow them to fund a £16 billion project. And I wanted to put this slide up as well, because although we've got political agreement, public opinion on nuclear is really, really important. Political opinion can shift very quickly, and it can shift quickly as public opinion and public view changes. You won't be able to read the question on here, but you probably can't read the dates either. 2002 is the date on the left, out to last Christmas, November, December 2014 on the right. And what this chart is showing is public responses to a question, the same question that we've asked every year. To what extent would you support or oppose the building of new nuclear power stations in Britain to replace those that are being phased out? So it's asking the public, random selection of the public every time, basically, do you want to keep the proportion of nuclear at about 20%, maybe going up to 25%, or replace the old ones with new ones as they close down? And 13 years ago in 2002, and a couple of years afterwards, the public said no. On average, they didn't want to see nuclear coming into to our electricity mix. Over that period, we started to have a lot of debate in the media around concerns about over-reliance on foreign energy supplies. We became a net importer of gas in about 2004, 2005. So all of our North Sea gas is now nearly run out, and we're importing gas from Europe and from Russia. We've seen a big concern about carbon emissions, which you'll be very familiar with, and the drive to bring in new low-carbon energy. And so over the last 10 years or so, public opinion has changed dramatically. And in Christmas 2010, when we did this polling, those numbers there, we saw the best numbers we'd ever had. 47% supported new nuclear, and only 19% were opposed. And we thought, how great is this? We've got the best public support we could have. We've got a government that's supporting new nuclear stations. What could possibly go wrong? And then we had Fukushima in Japan 3 months later in 2011, on March the 11th. We chose, as an industry, to go out and do some more opinion polling in the June of that year. And the reason we did it was we thought public opinion would have absolutely plummeted insofar as support for nuclear. We thought it would be almost on the floor. We wanted then the following December to be able to say it's improving a little bit and we're on the way back. So we didn't want to have to wait 2 years before we could point to some kind of an improvement. So we did some polling in June, and actually the public was still on average supportive. It had taken, as you can see, a massive drop from 47 to 36, but it was still higher level than the level of opposition. When we went back and polled again in December, 9 months after Fukushima, it was almost back to what it had been the previous Christmas. If we hadn't done that one in the middle, we probably wouldn't have believed the answers of at the end of 2011. But actually, the only reason I can give for that is that the whole public debate around nuclear that ran for weeks and months during that year highlighted so many of the pros and cons and was challenging about what the alternatives might be, that a lot of people started to think about energy supply and about nuclear perhaps for the first time. And since then, we've seen it pretty much stay fairly stable. So, as of today, about twice as many people support nuclear as opposed. There are still about 30% in all of those years, about 30% of people who don't know or don't care. So we shouldn't be complacent about that. That could change. But as of now, we see a pretty strong base of public support for nuclear. We've got a pretty good political situation, although I'm not tempted to fail by saying that. And as I say, I've talked about some of the plans we've got for new nuclear stations in the UK. So let me move on and talk a little bit. All of that, of course, is around uranium fuel and the traditional uranium fuel cycle. But I was asked if I'd specifically say a little bit about thorium and the role of thorium in the energy nuclear mix as well. Thorium is an element like uranium. It's CO. It only comes in one isotope. So when I talked about having to concentrate up the uranium to get the ones that we want, as many of those uranium isotope atoms into fuel elements as we could. We don't have to do that with thorium. It only comes in one naturally occurring type, which is thorium-232. But that doesn't itself generate the electricity. What that does is those atoms, if you throw a neutron at them, they will soak up that neutron to form another isotope. In fact, an isotope of uranium, uranium-233. which is a different uranium isotope than the one that we conventionally use to make electricity. So we're making a different flavour of uranium, if you like, and the thorium is really just a precursor to a different type of uranium fuel cell. That thorium is also fissionable if you hit it hard enough with a neutron. But what we're usually doing is adding a neutron to it to make uranium-233, which then goes on to form its own nuclear fission cycle. And you can see the different decay chain, thorium-232, through palladium into uranium and bottom. There is a lot more, well, not a lot more, there is more thorium in the world than there is uranium. So one of the attractions of thorium is you've got a whole new material, it's not being used for anything else. We don't need to enrich it. It's sitting around doing nothing in the Earth's crust, and we can mine it and have an alternative or an additional fuel cycle to the uranium cycle. It's not actually clear how much thorium there is because people haven't really gone out looking for it. And two of the key words in this, when we talk about reserves of anything, are the words economically extractable. Because you'll often hear experts, and I don't claim to be an expert, but you'll often hear experts ask how much whatever is there in the world, how much uranium is there, how much thorium is there, how much oil is there, how much gas is there. If anybody gives you a straight number in response to that question, they don't know what they're talking about. Because what you have to ask is how much are you prepared to pay to extract it? The more you're prepared to pay to dig deeper and deeper and get more coal, and leaner reserves and spend money on extracting it and purifying it, then the more of it you can have. You can get uranium from seawater, present in seawater in trivially small concentrations, and there's plenty of seawater. But it would never really be economically viable to take seawater and try and get uranium from. So with any of those questions about reserves, there's always the question of what's the market price you're prepared to pay. With things like gold, which is very valuable, people are prepared to mine deeper and deeper and go through very lean reserves of gold to get more and more of it out because of solar. So the question is, where is the world story? You may hopefully be able to read some of the comments here. There are about 6.5 million tonnes of thorium in the world compared to about 5.9 million tonnes of uranium at sort of current market prices. Most of the thorium, interestingly, is in India, which has its own uranium fuel cycle at the moment. Brazil has a lot, Australia has a lot, USA has a lot, Egypt, Turkey, Venezuela, you can see going down and down. We don't have any, as far as I'm aware. Whether anybody's ever looked in Manchester for thorium or deposits, or indeed uranium deposits, I'm not sure. Greenland has a certain amount. So you can see some countries on there you wouldn't necessarily associate with mining and with the nuclear industry. Interestingly, I mentioned India has the most thorium in the world. By a bizarre coincidence, India is doing a lot of the work to develop the thorium fuel cycle. Because if you happen to sit on large reserves of something, wouldn't it be nice if the rest of the world would like to buy that off you for a large amount of money? They're also interested in it with a massive population and a lot of economic growth that they're looking at. They'd like to have their own indigenous energy resource that they could use to power their own economy. So they are doing a lot of the work in the world to sort of develop a thorium fuel cycle at the moment. The reasons I won't go into, the Indians have never really been involved in international collaboration on the uranium fuel cycle. So they quite like to get their own variant of nuclear power that they could build in India for themselves and export around the rest of the world. But that thing I mentioned at the beginning about having to hit each atom of thorium with a neutron before it can become a uranium atom that can then go on to generate electricity, means that basically the development of a thorium fuel cycle will take a long, long time. You have to have a source of uranium, of neutrons, and you have to have a lot of time and patience to be able to hit the thorium with those neutrons to generate the starting point for getting the energy back out again. So whatever work is done, it's going to take several decades before we get a commercially viable thorium fuel cycle. And it's limited by the laws of physics rather than by people's ability to invest money or the ability to do the right science and research to get the technology in place. That doesn't mean it can't be done. So a word about, I mentioned economics already. On the plus side, we don't need to do the enrichment. The enrichment is a very expensive part of the fuel manufacturing process for uranium. And we don't know what uranium and thorium prices might be. If we see a big expansion in the uranium outside the conventional nuclear industry, we would expect uranium market prices to start going up as demand goes up. But thorium is harder to handle, and the uranium isotopes that come from thorium are quite hazardous. They generate their own higher levels of radiation than we get with conventional nuclear fuel manufacturers. So that means you have to put shielding and protection around fuel manufacturing lines that we wouldn't have to do with the uranium cycle, and that adds extra cost. There's also a lot of more research that needs to be done to get the right performance and the maximum efficiency out of the thorium cycle. I mentioned, if just by looking at the amount of waste that we produce from the historic UK industry compared with what we would see from a future generation of reactors, you can see how the technology has advanced so much to make it much more efficient and get the best use out of every bit that we're putting into that process. We're starting at the beginning again with thorium, so we'll be looking at basic technology, and it will take years to improve and optimise it. And I mentioned earlier on some of those first-of-a-kind problems just with different reactor design. It would be very, very difficult for a commercial company to say, we want to be the first one to build a thorium-powered reactor, and we're going to invest billions of pounds of our money in a whole fuel cycle that nobody's looked at before. So ultimately, it's going to need government support, most likely international collaboration through a number of governments to develop that technology to a point where commercial companies are prepared to jump on the other side of the fence and say, we'll spend our money on fuel plants and reactors for making thorium and burning thorium rather than sticking with what we've already got. So the short answer is, too soon to say whether thorium will be more commercially attractive than uranium. It certainly could be, but it's got a way to go to get there. It also has some proliferation resistance. Proliferation is the term we use in our industry for the diversion of material from the energy generating side of nuclear into the military and the weapons program. Uranium-233 can be used to make nuclear weapons. So although we're not generating the plutonium that we would have made with the conventional uranium cycle, we're still generating other material that could go and be diverted off for those malicious purposes. So the bodies that know classify uranium-233 as a dangerous material with significant quantities of a small number of kilograms in the same way as the highly enriched uranium. HEU is highly enriched uranium. So again, it has some advantages, but it's not perfect. We've actually been looking at thorium for a long, long time. It goes back to the very beginning of the industry when we started off on developing the uranium cycle. People were also looking at thorium back in the 1950s through to the 1980s. So there were research programs for a whole number of different reactor types into whether they could take on board thorium fuel. Some of that research is still around. A lot of the knowledge and the capability that was developed at that time is in people's heads, people who have now retired. So a lot of the knowledge and insight has been lost to the industry, and we'd have to recapture that. And to answer the question, you might be thinking, well, if we started it 60 years ago, why are we not there now? There were a whole number of reasons why that research didn't really progress. I mentioned the top one already, that it requires that priming with neutrons, and that's a time-consuming and a costly process. But the uranium fuel cycle, along with using plutonium within that cycle, was already established. So why do you need to create a new one if you've already got one, particularly when you've got a limited number of resources, and you're better off putting all of those resources on one technology and getting that perfected than splitting them. And that creates a massive barrier for any new system to come in and replace all of that knowledge and capability that's already there. Not just in the industry side of it as well, in terms of designing the fuel and designing the reactors, but the safety inspectors need to have that capability as well to be able to make the assessments as to whether it's safe. So if you haven't got regulators who know all about that technology, you're never going to be able to get it approved to operate, even if the technology itself is fully developed. And there are also issues around the recycling and reprocessing of thorium fuels, and again, there'd have to be a lot of research done in that area. So just to summarise with a couple of slides of advantages and disadvantages. I've mentioned some of these already. Thorium is more abundant than uranium, not vastly so, but there is a lot of it, and it doesn't have any other uses. It could be a major energy resource, particularly if we can get into what's called a breeding cycle of recycling material as well. in some aspects, and after a certain period of time, the waste material from the thorium fuel cycle will be less hazardous than from a uranium cycle. And there is no production of weapons-grade plutonium for use in thorium. Theoretically, as I said, the cost is lower, but that has to be proved. And actually, some of the material properties of the thorium fuel, things like the thermal conductivity of it, would be better than from uranium fuels. And when we think about ultimately disposing that fuel deep underground for final disposal, thorium is a more stable matrix than uranium is for going in a geological disposal facility. So it ticks a lot of the boxes, and if you look at that slide, you think it's a pretty good technology to pursue. But then you have the disadvantages, of course, as well. I've mentioned the issue of neutrons, and the conversion rate being low, and the time to build that up being very long. So for any organisation that was wanting to develop in the technology now, the lead time towards seeing that technology come to fruition is a long one, even by nuclear industry standards. Some of these I've mentioned, the reprocessing challenges and the need for technical and research development to prove some of those. I also mentioned the fact that the uranium-232 is a hazardous material, even at very, very low concentrations. And we are producing another weapons-usable material, even though it's not called plutonium. So many of the advantages have a flip side as well associated to them. And the bottom line is, in order to find out whether it really would be viable from a commercial point of view, there's a lot more research that would have to be done. I'm not going to read out that whole list of areas. Pretty much every aspect of the fuel cycle needs some more work before we can really better understand how thorium would compare with uranium. Including the one at the end of scenario modelling, of looking at how the whole big picture fits together. How does material move around from reactor to waste to potentially being recycled, being used again, what waste do we generate, how many different waste streams are there, how do we store them, and so on. So to summarise the kind of pros and cons, certainly a valuable strategic asset. I think many of us in the industry would like to see it developed, not to replace uranium, but to sit alongside uranium. Actually, that will help to make uranium reserves last longer. We can have two nuclear industries using different technologies, both generating low carbon electricity. Why would we not want that to happen in the long term? Sustainability is a big driver for that, as I mentioned. The radio toxicity benefit, the nuclear radiation coming off it, there is a benefit there, but it's not as great as some people have claimed. The proliferation resistance exists, but it's not as great as claimed. The economics, we just don't know. And even, I've taken this slide actually from the presentation of my colleague, and I think I would take issue when he says 15 to 20 years for commercial deployment. I would say you'd be lucky to see pilot scale demonstrator deployment in about 15 to 20 years. If you remember, the date for Hinkley Point C coming online is still 8 years away from where we are now, and we're talking about whole new technology. So I think maybe pilot scale plants in 15 to 20 years, maybe looking at more like 30, 35 years before you see a full scale commercial deployment of thorium. And from an industrial view, from an investor's view, if you like, I've mentioned there's a mix of advantages and disadvantages. The balance between those isn't yet established. And an important point, it will be context dependent. And what I mean by that is, it may not be the same for everybody. If you're the Indians sitting on top of a whole load of thorium, there might be other strategic political advantages for you in investing in that technology and using your own indigenous fuel rather than knowing you're going to be buying in your energy supplies for decades to come. If you're reliant on the world market, that might be a different answer. And it depends what your alternatives are in terms of electricity generation as well. Whatever way we look at it, there's a lot of research that needs to be done. And again, it's important to know what problem we're solving here. Are we developing this technology just because it's good science and we'd like to understand it better? Or is it really fixing a real current problem that we have in a way that is demonstrably better? And at the moment, people are just looking at it because it might be a bit different and it might have some advantages. But we have a pretty well-established uranium fuel cycle at the moment. So the bottom line, you'd expect somebody who works for a national laboratory to say this, we'd like to do some more research. And should be commissioned. Yeah, we get no money from government for doing that. If you want to know more about thorium, we do have a position paper on our website. This is the advert, by the way, if you didn't spot that. On the thorium fuel cycle, it's quite an old position paper, about 5 years old now. You can tell it's got our logo on the front, but it's freely available on our website. So to summarise what I've talked about, I've tried to cover quite a lot of ground in a relatively short period of time. The UK's nuclear industry is already a big contributor to our energy needs. The plans for new build, very much alive. I can't think of any other country in the world that has three developers looking at developing three different nuclear technologies within the same country at the same time. The next important step, and you'll be reading about it in the papers if it goes ahead, is the construction, the final decision to construct Hinkley Point C, and we very much hope to get that decision during 2015. Thorium certainly has a role to play in the future, or can have a role to play, most likely alongside uranium rather than replacing it, but there's a lot of technical and commercial challenges that still need to be overcome. And I think I said I'd talk for about 45 minutes, and I think I've just about done that. So thank you very much for staying attention. And I'm very happy to take any questions on anything I've talked about or anything else you think I might be able to answer. That's brave, isn't it? Oh, thank you. Gentlemen there.
So you say we're the only people who use gas cooled reactors. Why is that?
We're not the only people. We're the only people who use that particular design of gas cooled reactors. It's actually a political answer again. It goes back to the 1970s and the energy secretary at the time, who was Tony Benn, and he had to make a decision between do we want to basically take the design that's been put forward by British scientists and build that with the hope that we will then export it around the rest of the world, we can generate vast amounts of money by selling this technology to other countries, or should we take the technology that the rest of the world has already developed and just basically follow what they're doing? And he decided we would build the British design of technology. And we did, and we built four different flavours of it, and the rest of the world carried on doing what they had been doing before, of buying what they'd already bought before, because it was tried and tested and proven. And I think there's probably a lesson there that it's very difficult to bring a new technology in an area like nuclear, where the potentially the risks and the regulations are so high and the costs are so great. Why would you not just build something that someone else has already built successfully? That's the 30-second answer. There's probably about a three-year answer to that question as well.
When your reactors of all sorts, if there's a reactor that says it's going to carry on going for another 15 years, if you have some sort of technological advance whereby you know you can improve this reactor to make it more efficient, would it ever be economically viable to shut down a reactor for a period of time and make those improvements?
Yes, is definitely the answer. And it depends on exactly what that is. So a lot of the kind of reactors that we're talking about, water-cooled reactors, have to be shut down every 18 months anyway. They shut them down to replace about a third of the fuel each time. So every 18 months they take a third of the fuel assemblies out, they put a new third of them back in, or new fuel assemblies go in. And they take that opportunity to do as much other maintenance as they can during that window. So sometimes they will have it's a little bit like if you watch Formula One, where the car goes in for the pit stop and they change all the wheels and they clean the driver's visor and do everything else and refuel it, that used to refuel it years ago. Do everything at the same time in a matter of seconds. When they're doing a refueling outage on a reactor, it will usually be between about 15 and 25 days of downtime to do the refueling. They will do an awful lot of measuring and testing of materials to check that they know what condition everything is in. They'll do a lot of standard replacement of things, and if they have a technology advance, they'll try and introduce it at that time. There is always a balance, because some things that you could do would take longer than those 25 days. So if it might take 40 days to do it, you're then losing another 15 days of operation. But if it's a good enough improvement, why would you not do that and then get the benefit over the next 10, 15, 20, 30 years of operation? So the answer is yes, and they do all kinds of things. Yeah.
You mentioned a molten salt reactor, and it's been developed like quite early on, but it's still not in operation. Like, what's hindering the development?
It's a similar conversation to the thorium question. That at the moment we don't really need them. We have nuclear technologies that are in the shop window, ready to go. But people are looking at molten salt reactors. Some of it through international collaboration. So there's a program called the Generation 4. Program that's led in the United States that brings together about 8 or 9 big countries plus the European Union, so all the countries in Europe are partners in that. And they're looking at developing about half a dozen different advanced reactors, so the kind of thing that wouldn't be coming onto the, our power grids for the next 25 or 30 years. And a couple of those, I think, are molten salt reactors. Some of them could be thorium fueled. They don't have to be. So it's in that longer term, next generation area where a lot of it is being led by international collaboration because the costs are so great. And there'll come a point where individual countries will say, right, we've invested into the technology up to a certain point, now we'll take it away and develop our own program.
Is it like, is it due to the laws of physics, just like the thorium, that you can't produce any neutrons?
It's not, not specifically, because you could do some of the molten, we've done quite a lot of molten salt experimental work, so the technology is, has a different set of pros and cons, but you're dealing with again, very hazardous material, it's obviously molten, so it's, that brings its own challenges rather than being, being solid fuel. So it's just different technical challenges, and the barriers to overcoming those are still quite hard. Yeah?
So you know you showed like right at the start when all these reactors are being shut up and closed. Are they being shut for, like completely shut, or are they being closed to improvement?
Those will be the final closure dates that I put up. So that's the date at the moment where the operators have got their license from the safety inspectors to run the designs up until that point. They may be able to get lifetime extensions beyond that, but that's not guaranteed. And those advanced gas cooled reactors have already had lifetime extensions for a first time.
Why can't they be run like indefinitely until they find a reason why it might be
unsafe? Well, they kind of can. In a sense, they can. So if you didn't hear the question, why can't they be run indefinitely? Let me use a slight analogy if I can. If you go to a car dealership down the road and you buy a brand new Mercedes-Benz car, you won't have to take it for its MOT for 3 years. But after 3 years, you've got to go and take it to a garage to get its MOT certificate to prove that it's still roadworthy. Now, the salesman, and pretty much anybody, would be fairly confident you're not just going to be able to drive that car for 3 years. But you have to get it inspected periodically to make sure that all of the parts are still working, that the brakes haven't worn out or whatever. And it's similar with reactors. Initially they get a design lifetime approval from the regulators to run them for say 25 years. And then after that they keep having to go back for a periodic review and inspection to make sure that everything is working as it should. The advanced gas cooled reactors, for instance, all have graphite reactor cores, so the core, the fuels assemblies sit in cores of channels between solid graphite blocks, and the graphite deforms and it loses a lot of material over decades in a high temperature, high radiation environment. So the material properties of that graphite are one of the things that will determine how long those reactors can safely operate for. And nobody knows that because we nowhere else in the world have we got that material that's been irradiated and subjected to 30 years of high radiation, high temperature. So the only way we can get that information is by taking samples and analysing them, which we actually do for EDF, to keep checking how safe it is. And they literally go in and drill little cores out of the graphite and send them to us, and we find out the material properties, and that then goes to the regulator to help make the safety case. So those dates may extend. They could even come forward as well if something is discovered, a crack or some issue that would close the reactors early. But at the moment, that's what they've got a lifetime, a license to operate.
So, Horizon introducing these boiling water rates, which you say haven't been in the UK before, how are the differences of pressurized water and boiling water?
In a pressurized water reactor, all of the fuel is the primary circuit, if you like, all of the area where the fuel sits is cooled by water that always stays as water. So, it's at very high pressure, very high temperature, it never boils, but it goes all the way through that circuit and loses its heat through a heat exchanger to a secondary circuit that generates steam. In a boiling water reactor, the fuel assemblies are covered with water, but that water actually boils, and it's steam that goes around the circuit to drive the turbine directly.
Interesting fact is that the Fukushima reactor was a big boiler.
It was
boiling water.
Boiling water, that's right. The Fukushima reactors were boiling water reactors. That doesn't mean they're inherently unsafe.
No. We need to put your cooling pumps on steam.
and not build them in a highly in a high earthquake region.
Not build them at Hinkley Point, which is in the Somerset level, which flooded.
Yeah, there's a difference between flooding and tsunamis.
Yeah.
I have a whole other talk on Fukushima if you want that one, but you didn't book me for that. Sorry, any other? Yeah.
You mentioned that the kind of mechanism of energy generation and thorium is actually putting through the decay chain to a fissionable uranium isotope,
yeah,
and then using that to get the rest of it. Are we aware of any other kind of heavy metals like thorium that could potentially go through the decay chain to hamilton?
That's a really good question. People have done a lot of work looking at what other elements there might be or what other isotopes there might be that could fuel nuclear generation. There are ways in which people can take highly radioactive waste and get rid of it by bombarding it with neutrons, for instance. And there are other potentially other candidate materials, but most of them would take you to a uranium chain at some point. And it would be such a torturous route to get there that really uranium and thorium are the only two realistic candidates. Plutonium is another fuel, but that's only generated by the use of uranium in nuclear reactors. So really, uranium, plutonium and thorium are the three real candidates for a nuclear fuel cycle.
Right.
But if you think of another one, do let us know, because there's more research we can do. Anybody who's not asked a question before I come back to the gentleman there? Don't go on then.
What do you think about the nuclear fusion reactor planning to be built by the French?
Well, again, it's actually planning, the nuclear fusion project is in France, but it's actually an international collaboration. So the British are involved in that. We have our own nuclear fusion research centre, the Cullum Centre for Fusion Energy, which is kind of our counterpart. We in the National Lab just do nuclear fission. They do fusion. We work with them on a whole load of things like mathematical modelling and advanced materials. Fusion is probably about 40 years away in terms of commercial deployment. And I know everybody, 40 years ago it was also 40 years away. It's one of those areas where they are making big improvements. They've just had, I think a few weeks ago, they had one of the best test results there at the UK facility that they've had in a long, long time, down in Cullum. And the next one in France is set to be bigger and better still. But even that, I don't think is likely to generate commercial quantities of electricity. That's still just a pilot plan for what would come after that. So the timescales are always very long. You're only going to see that work done through international collaborations. But I think ultimately it will come, but probably not in my lifetime. That's a safe bet to make, isn't it? Because
I think we're going to finish there for questions. Use the time we pick it all up. Thanks for being here.